Hello, everybody. Today, we're going to discuss an important topic. Resistance in vulvovaginal candidiasis is a large and growing problem. I'm Dr. Mark Martens, and I'm chairman of obstetrics and gynecology at the Jersey Shore University Medical Center, and also clinical professor and vice chairman at Rutgers Robert Wood Johnson School of Medicine. In the past, the species that make up the etiology of vulvovaginal candidiasis was fairly simple. It was mostly Candida albicans, and in the past, meaning more than 15 or 20 years ago, 95% of all Candida infections were Candida albicans. However, with the introduction of oral medications, which affect the GI tract, and we'll discuss more about this later, there was a shift in the Candida species to other non-albicans yeast. The most frequent currently is still Candida glabrata, which used to be called Torulopsis glabrata, and then Candida parapsilosis is next, and then crucii, and a few more. Now, it looks like in this study from the early 2000s, at almost 30% of infections are now caused by non-albicans species. The way to think about these complicated infections are either as recurrent or resistant infections. Recurrent infections are susceptible to our antifungal agents we currently use, but because of repeated exposure, antibiotic use, or other factors, they come back over and over. But generally, it's the same species with the same sensitivity. Resistance is a different entity, where the candida is not susceptible to the agents that are being used, and the patient continues to have the infection. They may feel better for a while as you reduce part of a mixed infection, or the topical agents have an emollient effect. However, as soon as this treatment is over, they develop the symptoms again. Let's start with recurrent vulvovaginal candidiasis. The definition, according to the CDC, is 4 more yeast infections in a year. Although only 5% of patients will have recurrent infections, these are the ones that are most difficult to treat. The reason why someone with susceptible yeast cannot clear it is often very complicated. We know the reasons: diabetes because of their higher sugar levels, and immunocompromised patients. So with recurrent and resistant yeast infections, the main point is to understand that the gastrointestinal tract is a source for these infections. Patients eat bread, they eat fruit, and most of their food isn't cooked or sterile, and therefore they ingest the yeast. That yeast is now in their gastrointestinal tract, and it multiplies because it's a warm, moist, and very favorable environment. These yeasts then exit the gastrointestinal tract, and no matter how hard women try to keep themselves clean, they're going to have microscopic amounts of bacteria and yeast that will make their way to the genital tract area. Antibiotic use may alter the pH of the vagina by killing the lactobacilli. The lactobacilli are the agents that make lactic acid, and good lactobacilli also make hydrogen peroxide. They keep the pH of the vagina low, and this helps to prevent bacterial and yeast infections. However, when you take an antibiotic and when you eliminate your lactobacilli, the candida have a chance to grow. They grow from a cellular stage to a hyphal stage. The hyphal stage are finger-like projections that penetrate into the patient's vaginal epithelium. Patients then develop an itch. It's an actual growth of the mycelia into the skin that causes them to itch. As we look at the trends in resistance, let's start with Candida albicans infection. When you take an oral agent such as fluconazole, 1% is distributed to your vagina. The rest is distributed to your GI tract, your bloodstream, and other tissues in your body. Fortunately, that 1% of fluconazole is good enough to kill most of the Candida albicans. However, when you select out species that are resistant to fluconazole, which you do when you take it orally, the elevated levels of fluconazole in your GI tract kill all the susceptible yeast, but what remains in the GI tract are species that are resistant to fluconazole. That's why when you develop the next infection, the only thing present are resistant species. When you treat resistant species topically, you don't affect the source of the yeast, which is in the GI tract. However, if you use fluconazole, you then kill the susceptible strains and allow resistant strains to take over. That's why after a decade or more of increasing fluconazole use, you can see an increase in the non-albicans species. So as you can see from the slide, with fluconazole use over the past 10 to 15 years, there's been an increase in the minimum inhibitory concentration, the MIC. This has increased from 1 to 2, which may not seem like much, but what you're talking about is a doubling or tripling of the resistance. So the recent study that we did in 2013 looked at 100 patients coming through with yeast infections. We now see that 50% were Candida albicans and 50% were non-albicans species. Also, of these 9 species, there was an increase not just in the glabrata, but in parapsilosis, crucii, and other species. This is relevant because it's very difficult to diagnose these non-albicans species with current laboratory methods. Many of the tests that the laboratories used are based on a 20- or 30-year-old protocol that looks specifically for Candida albicans. Some laboratories may now look for Candida glabrata, but even if you test and look for both Candida glabrata and Candida albicans, you're still going to miss a third of the yeast. So if you think it's yeast and it acts like yeast, and you've ruled out other infections like bacterial vaginosis and trichomoniasis, you should treat these patients for yeast. But it's likely that these Candida infections are becoming more resistant. And remember, as the use of fluconazole has increased, it's likely that resistance has increased. The answer in the past was the first dose worked, the second dose not so well, give them more doses of fluconazole. But as you can see in the next slide, this has created a bigger problem. In this slide, you see that about half the patients get one dose, which has worked for years and years. But with the increasing MIC, the way to do that was to increase your level as you developed resistance. You can do that with a second dose, or a third dose, or a fourth dose. So you can see about half the patients now are initially prescribed more than one dose, because physicians, nurse practitioners, other healthcare personnel have seen that one dose just doesn't cut it anymore. And half of the doses that are given out are more than one dose even to begin with. Unfortunately, many of these regimens are within a few days of each other. The half-life of fluconazole is very lengthy, so when you're giving more than one dose a week, it's going to build up and not get the lasting results. So what happens is you get more and more patients getting additional doses. And as you can see, even these physicians, nurse practitioners, midwives that prescribe one tablet, one out of five will get a call back saying that it doesn't work and request another tablet. The CDC admits that diagnosis and symptoms are difficult to match. 50% of patients positive for a non-albicans species have minimal or different symptoms. It's because they don't have hyphae infiltrated in the skin. It's the hyphae that cause that intense itching. With non-albicans species, they don't have a hyphal stage, and in a cellular stage, they appear to cause more of an irritation. So symptoms may not be itching. It may be an irritation. It may be a burning. The International Society of Vulvovaginal Diseases has some guidelines for yeast infection treatment. They've spent many hours and had many discussions and now recommend the use of miconazole because of its spectrum of activity. They have also recommended it for the use in Candida glabrata infections, which is, as you know, the most common of the non-albicans species. Some infections will tend to recur, and if recurrence occurs, extended use of a topical agent is generally recommended. I personally use a 7-day regimen, and if that doesn't work, I then go to a 14-day regimen. The next step is boric acid vaginal capsules, 600 milligrams in a capsule, and can be used once a day or twice a day, up to 14 days. I also have a tapering regimen, but that depends upon the severity of the case and the length of the symptoms. Again, you can see the recommendations from the International Society for the Study of Vulvovaginal Disorders. They have an app that you can download. It is very extensive, has a list of many treatment regimens for all the different species of Candida. The first-line agent for Candida glabrata, as you can see, is miconazole and nystatin. So now, how did the Society come to these recommendations? As you can see, they looked at the list of species and the sensitivity to all the currently available agents, and the agent with the broadest activity was miconazole. So this is the preferred agent, as it treats over 98% of the yeast infections. There are drug-to-drug interactions when using an oral agent. So as you can see, women with diabetes, women on oral contraceptives, and women on other drugs metabolized by the liver, have alterations in their levels. Agents such as statins, warfarin, hypoglycemics, cyclosporine, etc., will be affected by the use of oral fluconazole. As you can see, a patient on oral contraceptive fluconazole has a change in her hormone levels. While this change is an average of 30%, in some patients it could be as high as 60%. Last year, there were two very large studies reported. One in Denmark looked at over 1.4 million pregnancies. They have great registries in Europe because of the socialization of their medical system, and they found that there was an increase in miscarriages and spontaneous abortion with women that were exposed to oral fluconazole compared to women who were treated with local therapy. The Accelerate study was a very nice study that I saw presented at the American College of OBGYN in 2015. Dr. Bachman from Rutgers Robert Wood Johnson School of Medicine looked at the speed of relief of two agents, one oral fluconazole and the other monistat. She compared 300 patients that received either a one-day ovule or a single dose of fluconazole orally. As you can see with the monostat, patient reported relief within 1 hour. It took longer for the fluconazole to be effective because it has to be ingested, it has to be absorbed, and has to be distributed by the blood to the vagina. So with 4 times faster onset, the monostat ovule was very helpful for patients who said their symptoms were very severe. Recently, we did a study that collected feedback from over 3,000 physicians and nurse practitioners and their patients. The physicians and nurse practitioners provided monostat or miconazole to each patient who was diagnosed with a yeast infection. Fortunately, 94% of them got great relief and never wound up coming back and calling the office. 1/3 of their patients reported this was their first time to have a yeast infection, and 100% of those who have not been exposed to other agents in the past. 100% of these patients said that the monostat gave them relief and that it would use it again. In summary, I want to bring up 5 points. Number one, Candida resistance to miconazole is low despite widespread use of this drug. Number two, non-albicans species are becoming more prevalent and more difficult to treat. Number three, miconazole provides broader treatment for yeast infections than other prescription and over-the-counter vulvovaginal treatments. This includes oral fluconazole and topical terconazole, making miconazole a good first-line choice for many infections. Number four, topical agents have been shown to have fewer side effects and drug interactions than the oral agents. And number five, the increasing trend toward resistance is very concerning, yet options exist to reduce this impact. Thank you for joining us today.